So our first session today is using Linux tools. So SDES is the same as the name of this course, which is Software Development Techniques for Engineers and Scientists. So when we introduced this course in IIT Bombay, that is when we were recommended a small change in the name of the course. We are not calling it Software Engineering the way it is called in this, but it is titled Software Development Techniques for Engineers and Scientists. For any questions, please interrupt us in the chat or directly, and we will take up questions in the middle. Answering your questions is helpful so that others who will have the same questions will also become clear. Hence, please don't hesitate in asking questions. Please make this very interactive. If it were a regular classroom, it would certainly be interactive. Now we want you to take the initiative to make this an interactive session. So the outline for the two sessions of today is as follows. So we will quickly do some getting started related commands, then we will do some basic file handling in Linux. So for those who are new to this, you would have already seen the Moodle slides for this. So Linux commands are almost the same as Unix commands. So these commands are going to be relevant for both Unix and Linux. So most importantly, we will study something called the shell. So a shell is also called a prompt. How to use the shell to our advantage is what we will see in the whole of using Linux tools. So we will also see some text processing, typically cut, paste, copy, and some simple shell scripts. So what is FOSS? Free and open source. Linux is an example, and this is free, not like we have something which is free for using. This is free in the sense that one can also modify, a very important difference. Just free would mean like free beer, somebody has given us some free food, but this is free in the sense that it is open source, we can modify, we can use it for any purpose we like. The Linux itself is inspired by Unix. So there is a small difference between the licenses. So Linux is also called GNU. So these are some introduction about Linux. This is best seen on Moodle. So at the time of logging in, one typically sees GUI for the Linux nowadays, but then there was a time when there used to be only shell based logging in, only shell based working. Only now we also have a GUI. Thanks to the GUI, Linux has become very popular, but it is only Windows type popularity that is coming into Linux because of the GUI. There is a very large power of Linux that is underutilized because the shell aspect is not used. So we will see that in more detail today. So the most important thing is when we are working in a shell, then we want to always know which working directory are we working in now. So this is what we will see as a shell. So this dollar that is shown here is what is called the prompt, and because something is blinking there, it is waiting for us to type. I am typing random letters now, but one types at the prompt, and one can of course enter it, but these are not meaningful commands. So it says this command is not found. So our first important command we will study is called pwd. It tells what is the present working directory. Pwd stands for the present working directory. On the slides it says home user, while on our when we on the shell when we run it, it says home SDES. That is because on this computer we are currently in the working directory home SDES. So we can also see what are the various directories files inside this. We can go into a directory by using the command cd, cd for change directory. Many of the Linux commands are very meaningful and very suggestive, the commands are very self explanatory, but the very commonly used ones are all abbreviated. So ls stands for list, cd stands for change directory. So these are extremely commonly used, and hence we have small commands for these. So let us go into the directory called desktop. So please notice that this is very case sensitive. So now we have gone into the desktop directory. we can go back. This dot dot stands for back, that is what we will see in more detail now. So I really hope that many of you have seen the Moodle slides, so that we can do this faster. In the IIT Bombay course, for example, we do this over 2 weeks, but then because the slides are available, we would like to go faster. So we are again in the directory we started with. As I said, we did CD desktop to go into the directory called desktop. How did we know that there was a directory called desktop? Yeah, we did ls and saw that there is this directory called desktop. This particular shell, it colors the directories in a different color from the files. Yeah, so that is why black examples.desktop is a file that is coming in black, while the directory names are all coming in blue. To give an example that this is indeed case sensitive, so let us type this. Then we see that desktop with a slightly different spelling. In fact, the spelling is same, only the capital has been written as small, and it says that such a file or directory does not exist. So please note that Linux shell commands are all very much case sensitive, and hence you please note what is capital, what is small. So we are here to check that we indeed went into the desktop directory. Let us type present working directory pwd again. So here we are in home SDES desktop. Yeah. So we can now go into another subdirectory called ult. So now we are in home SDES desktop ult. So this is how one navigates through through the prompt, through the directories. Okay, let us go to the slides again. So we saw ls already. So when the slides were made, in that directory there were different files, as you would guess. So now we will see how to make a directory. Yeah. So if you inside this particular directory we are in, we can make a new directory, and we generally don't recommend the names of files and directories to have a space in the middle. We will see what is the problem because of that very soon in this course. So let us also see a few more slides and then start practicing them together. So let us make a directory here. So we are in this directory. We see that there are some there is examples and ult.pdf. Yeah, it appears like examples is a directory, that is, as I said, because the color is like that, but one can do ls minus l in more detail to give all this long list. Yeah, so we would like to say that this particular is a command. It has some arguments, it has some optional arguments. These are like options. We say that these are options. So every option typically starts with minus sign. So just ls gave us a list of files, but we did ls minus l to see that some of these are directories. It says directories. What this additional rwx is, that is something we will see later today. So it also says what is the last time it was modified, etc. It says that there is one directory called examples. We can make a new directory, make dir new directory. So we have this three things now. We see that the new directory is also a directory. How do we know it is a directory? This particular letter that is highlighted, the D there means it is a directory. Similarly for examples also, while if it is for file, it is only dash. You can go to more advanced things and see that there are D, dash, S, various things are also possible instead of just file or directory. Let us go to this new directory, and there is nothing yet. Of course, there is nothing because we created it just now. So how, what is the meaning of going back? Yeah. So when we are here, so we are inside this home SDS desktop ult new directory. We entered into the new directory by cd new directory. we would like to go one step before. So this dot dot stands for the parent directory. This is, we are in the present directory, the current directory, and the previous directory to which this is linked is called the parent directory. In order to go there, one says cd dot dot, and we see that we have gone to the previous directory. Now this directory handling through the prompt is extremely important. I am sure you can also do this using a GUI in which one typically sees up arrow mark to go to the parent directory. So, but then to do it through the shell is very powerful. One can write scripts to go to various directories, do something, come back. That would not be possible using the mouse and clicking again and again. If you want to automate something, that is when the script is really demonstrating its power. So double dot we have already used. We have not said what is single dot. Yeah, ls dot. Dot means current directory. Yeah. So if we do, if we are already here, we already saw what is cd dot dot. It will go one directory before. But cd dot means what? It's the same one. As I said, dot means the current directory. There are various places where we need to explicitly use the dot when we are moving between directories, when we are moving a file between directories, when we are copying one file from another directory to here, that is when we really require the dot. Now that is how we already saw how to make a new directory. Let us see how to make a new file. Yeah. So the new file is most easily created by using the command called touch. New file. So we have two directories, two files, the ult.pdf and new file, both are files. It's not required that you give an extension to the file. ult.pdf is a file with an extension, but the new file is not. It doesn't have an extension. Is it because that ult.pdf has an extension, that is why it is shown in a different color? Yeah, these are things you can see in more detail by ls minus l. Yeah. So I should say we will see this in more detail, but this execute aspect, yeah, there is this ult.pdf, it is just a pdf file, but it has been made due to incorrect copying, for example, into this, it has been made into an executable file. Yeah, we do not need to execute the ult.pdf, one just views the pdf file. In spite of that, it has been made into executable file. We will see this in more detail when we see the command chmod. One important thing to note is in Linux and Unix, one does not decide whether it is a PDF file or text file just based on the extension. The file also has some information about this. For example, we can use the command file for ult.pdf and see what it is. The file ult.pdf, it says is a PDF document with so and so version. Yeah. If you copy the ult, the command to copy is cp, yeah, cp source destination, cp ult.pdf to new file 1 dot, let us say doc. Yeah, nobody prevents us from giving the doc extension. So we have more files now. Let us see file new file 1 dot doc. It still says it is a PDF document. Yeah, so notice that just because you chose to give it a doc extension does not make it a doc file. It is, it still continues to be a PDF file. This is one very important difference between Linux and Unix ways of knowing a file from Windows, from Microsoft Windows method of knowing, recognizing a file. Okay, let us continue to the next slide. So it is, if we have heard of some command or if we know that this is a specific command and we want to know in more detail how to use it, that is when one requires some help about that command. So one of them is what is. Yeah. There are three, there are at least two ways of finding a help here. One is what is touch, one is man touch. Yeah. So what is just gives some very basic information about what that command is. Yeah. If you are confused between two commands and you know what they are doing, it is just a small confusion. Then what is the command to use for this purpose? So as I said, this particular thing that we type immediately at the prompt is called what is called the command. Yeah, in this case the prompt has a dollar here. We in our particular shell also there was a dollar, but one can have any information in the prompt. One can have a longer prompt if required. This is a command, and this command takes an argument. Yeah, so this touch is a argument. So the, if you want to know how to use the command called touch, then you will use the command called what is, and give this touch itself as an argument. Argument to which? Argument to this command. Yeah. One can get more detailed information using the command man. Man means manual. We recommend that you try this on your own computer. But when you use what is command, it will just give that information, come back to the prompt. Yeah. One, you do not have to type anything to quit from that particular information page. Unlike man, because man is a very detailed information, you type man touch and it opens a page with lots and lots of information, plenty of screen fulls of information, and then you have to know how to quit and come out of that. So remember to press Q and quit out. Yeah. One can also see in more detail the manual for the man command itself by man man. So one can also get some information by minus h option. And this, as I said, minus sign is like an option, option to this command. So using minus h, one can get some help. For example, if you want to know how to list not just the file in this directory, but across all subdirectories, then minus r is an option. But you do not have to remember what option to use for some advanced things. Always you will learn to use help and learn it when you require it. We are not going to test memory for any of these commands for any advanced purpose. So if there is also something called apropos, it searches for a command inside various man pages. That is extremely useful. Okay, let us go to file handling. So we already learned how to copy a file. If you want to remove a file, then rm is a command to use. Rm means for remove, rm and file name. Yeah, the same command can be used for directories also, but not the default way. Rm works for files like this. If it is a directory, then because there is this potential problem that we might remove an entire directory thinking it's only a file, and there might be plenty of useful files inside it. That is why explicitly we have to say minus r. That is, r generally stands for recursive. So minus r means remove the directory recursively. Inside the directory you go, remove any files there. If there are subdirectories, go further into the subdirectories, recurse through them and remove them all. Rmdir can also be used for this purpose. We already saw cp. Yeah, cp, we copied one file from the current directory to another file in the same directory. Yeah, cp source destination. But one can do this across directories also. Yeah. So it's important to note that cp will also overwrite files. Yeah, if that destination is already a file, like already an existing file, then that will get easily overwritten. So we will see this as an example. So we did cp ult.pdf to new file 1.doc. Yeah, we did this and created the new file 1.doc. Let us do this again. It has overwritten, it appears. Yeah, it did not tell here that it has overwritten. So again we have the same set of files. It is not clear that we have overwritten really. Yeah, so let us do file new file. This was a new file we created using the touch command. Let us now copy this ult.pdf to new file. Yeah, and then let us check its file type. So this really proves that we have overwritten the file new file, overwritten it using ult.pdf. New file was already an existing file which we had first created using the touch command. Now we have overwritten it using ult.pdf, and more generally we are concerned that when we are copying a file from a source to a destination, this overwriting might happen, and we do not want this to happen. That is when we are going to use the minus I, I for interactive, yeah. Interactive, yeah. Yeah. So let us do this again. Now it is asking whether we should really overwrite or not. Yeah, this is just a warning for us. We could alias the CP command to CP minus I, so that always we are prompted whether we really intend to overwrite or not. So we can now choose to say yes or no. Yeah. So if it is yes, then we'll overwrite it. Yeah, I was telling you that when we are copying or moving, that time we need to know this destination. So this CP command, it is not automatic. Yeah, if you are doing ult.pdf, you have to give a destination, CP source destination, with or without options. Minus, as I said, are options, and there's always a default. So minus I is never compulsory. In none of the options are compulsory, there is a default option always, but the source is compulsory and the destination is compulsory. So for example, CP source, and if you forget to give the destination, it will not work. Yeah, it is especially important if, for example, look at all the files that are then examples directory. Now suppose you want to copy a file from examples directory to copy the particular bar.txt file from within the examples directory to here. It will say, look, there is no destination. Yeah. So, for those who are noticing that I am able to type so much faster, please note that one uses the tab command, yeah, tab key in bash for all kinds of auto completion. Yeah. For example, this is a small digression from what we are doing. There is an examples directory. Suppose you want to go to examples, you type cd, the command itself has to be typed. Then ex, if we type, now I am going to about to press the tab key, it is going to complete it. The whole completion has taken place by the pressing of just one tab key, extremely useful. It will complete only as long as there is no ambiguity. If there is an ambiguity, then it will stop there. For example, we could also make a directory called exam, and we could do cd ex and then tab. Then if we press this, it will, if we press e and then press tab, it will complete only as much as possible. It is stopped there because there is an ambiguity. A second tab will give us what all is possible. Yeah, okay. Now we are trying to, let us go back. We were copying a directory, particular file from examples to here. That is when, and if we want the file name to be the same, we are not intending to change the file name. That is when we will just give it dot. This means copy bar.txt inside the examples directory to the same file name in the current directory. Just putting the dot now has helped that no destination needs to be given explicitly. Let us see what all files are created. There is bar.txt that is been copied here also. Yeah, it was not there here. Notice what all is there here. There are only these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 files and directories. Let us copy another thing from examples. foo.txt, we will copy here, and now we see that there is foo.txt also. foo.txt was not there first, it has come now. One user to clear the screen after having typed various things, to clear the screen, one can type clear. There is a shortcut called Control L that also clears. Okay, let us go to the next slide. R for recursively copying a directory, including all its subdirectories and files inside the subdirectories, all will get copied in one go using the R command, using the R option. One can also use the MV command for moving. if you are not interested in just copying, if you want to move a file from one place to another, one option is to copy it from there to here. After checking that it has copied very properly, then you can go ahead and remove the old one. But it is unlikely that something goes wrong in this unless the files are really big. So, one can also do move, nothing goes wrong with move. So, MV command moves the source from the source location to destination. So, move source destination. Now, I again for interactive, if you are concerned about overwriting, as I said, if the overwriting is not an issue, then it will not prompt you for yes or no. It will ask you only if there is a possibility of overwriting, only if overwriting is going to happen potentially. Please note that we are not doing the minor details, because I assume you would have gone through the slides. There is a question from VIT Vellore.
Sir, I tried to copy from the, that is Ubuntu is on one source, and I tried to copy from another D drive or some other drive, but it is not copying. I want to copy from other directory.
Directory, yeah. So, can you?
That means other volume.
Are you able to see the different volumes, the different directories in Ubuntu?
Yes, sir. I can.
So we
I can.
These different drives, I believe, are because there was some partitioning done according to Windows. Yeah. So in Linux, we do not use these C or D drives. So it is recommended that you use the tab for auto completion. This use of the tab will ensure, for example, that we use forward slash instead of backslash. Right. So in Windows, one typically uses backslash between directory names inside a long directory, subdirectory, subdirectory. Inside that one uses slash, but in Windows one uses backslash, and in Linux one uses forward slash. This is a very common mistake, but then such mistakes are automatically ruled out if you use auto tab, auto completion using tab. So we recommend that you first practice copying source to destination between various files in the same directory. Then you go to copying files between various directories inside the same larger directory, and then you go to copy across volumes. Yeah, for example, when copying a file from a pen drive to the hard disk in Ubuntu, one has to do it across volumes, across partitions. That is something that we recommend using the tab. That is when it will complete and ensure that all the slashes, all the spellings are correct. Yeah, so we recommend that you do this. But then this is a question that is a little more of the advanced nature, which we are sure you will do if you are given little more time. So please do this little later. Are there any other question? Thank you very much for asking this.
Sir, one more thing.
Yeah, please do. Please ask.
Sir, when I type cd dot dot, it has to suppose to move to a parent directory.
Yeah.
But it is not moving. Instead, if I put cd, it is going to the parent directory.
Sure. Thank you very much for asking this question. This is something almost everybody, each one of us, when using Linux for the first time, will certainly encounter this. Yeah. Thank you very much for asking. So this is something I will address to the entire thing again slowly. Are there any other questions which I can ask, which I can answer together?
No, sir. It's very good, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Please. Please ask. Yeah.
Suppose I am renaming a file. I am copying a file, that is a PDF file, to another file. Like suppose first is a PDF file, and I am copying it to first one. What will be the default extension for that file?
There were two important questions. One question is that somebody had typed, for example, here. So one typed, somebody has typed cd dot dot and it don't work, but they typed cd, just cd, and it worked. So please keep in mind that in Linux, command then space is very important. Yeah, there is always a space between the command and option. There is a space between option and argument. Between two arguments, space is always required to be there. Because the space is required to be between the command and argument, space is the key thing that separates different arguments, it separates the command from the argument. That is why we do not keep space inside the file name itself. Inside one file name, we do not keep a space, because space is already playing such a key role for all other things. In case the space is already there, then we will teach very soon how to escape that particular character. That is a little more advanced thing. So, first important thumb rule, never use space inside file names and directory names. Now, between CD and dot dot, if you do not leave the space, that is when we get command not found. Yeah. Now, if we do this, then we indeed the command has worked, it has gone to one parent directory. But CD also, instead of giving dot dot as an argument or giving the directory name as an argument, if you do not give any argument, if you just press CD, then it goes to again it appears like parent directory only because we were in desktop. Yeah. So, this particular directory we started with is also called our home. Yeah, this is the home directory we enter when we log in into the system. When one logs in into this computer, then one reaches the home, and this home is where we will reach when we use the CD command from any other directory. Just to give an example, suppose we go to desktop and then ult, and I think examples was there. This is the directory, we do CD dot dot, we go just one before, yeah. But now if you press CD, then it has gone to two directories before. In fact, any other place we could have been, and when we press, when we type just CD, we come to the home directory. This for this particular computer and for this user called SDES, this is the home directory. Yeah, if you are in some other directory called desktop ult, if we are here and we want to know where will we go if we press just CD, then home is one particular shell variable we will like to say, we will see this later today. But home is a variable that captures this information. Where will you go if you press just CD? You will go to the home directory. The home directory, that home variable is extremely important. All your files are there and inside, that is where you have access to write, etc. So, this answers one important question about CD. So, CD space dot dot is extremely important. The space, please notice where I am typing the space, always space is required between the argument and the command, between one argument and another argument, it is required between option and argument, etc. Between options, the various options themselves can be combined without a space. Yeah, that is the only place where space, if you do not put, nothing will go wrong. All the options can be combined together without a space. The next question was that when we create a new file, what extension do we give? Does Linux automatically give an extension, or do we only have to always choose? So, unlike Windows, here unlike Microsoft Windows, in Unix and Linux, one can choose any file, any extension. It is only a convention to give doc extension for doc files, PDF extension for PDF files, tech, T-E-X extension for LaTeX files. This is only a convention. All the commands will work even if you use a very irrational extension policy, the commands will still work. For example, ult.pdf. So, we are here, we see that there is this ult.pdf file, ult.pdf, we can see double F has caused a problem, it is a PDF file. Yeah. We remember that we copied a ult.pdf into newfile.pdf, newfile1.doc. Yeah. This is not a good naming policy, I did this only for the sake of demonstration. That is also a PDF file. How do you view PDF files? There is a viewer called events. You can view that for viewing the ult.pdf, for example. This is the same presentation that you are viewing on AView with better resolution. We can use events also for viewing new file 1.doc. Yeah, why? Because it is actually a PDF file. Yeah, so Evans has opened it, even though it's a doc file. To say it's a doc file is not the correct usage of language. Why? Because file command is telling you that it's a PDF file. Yeah, Evans, as I said, is for viewing PDF files. Let us try to view foo.txt. Yeah, foo.txt is really a text file, and if you view it, it says unable to open document because it is not actually a PDF file. Yeah. So please note that no matter what extension you give, if it is a PDF file, then a PDF viewer will automatically recognize and open it. It will not need to recognize; it will open the PDF file directly. Yeah. If it is not a PDF file, and still if you insist it's a PDF file, it will not be able to open. Yeah. This is the other problem we can quickly try. We will copy foo.txt, which is actually a text file, into foo.pdf. Yeah, this is certainly not a good thing to do, but now let us see if Evans PDF viewer gets cheated. Yeah, if you do this, it doesn't open. It says file type plain text. Actually, the file type is a plain text document. It is not a PDF file. This much Evans has understood. That is why it said it is not a PDF file. We could also see foo.pdf and see it says actually it is just plain ASCII English text. We can see what is this PDF file, and it says some information, some plain text. Plain text is viewed using less. You can use less and the file name for viewing a plain text file. Remember to use Q to exit out of that. There is one more question from Kolhapur. There are two questions on chat which we will take up first. Which Linux version do you recommend? Yeah, that is one question. Other is what is the difference between move and move minus I? Minus I, as I said, is for interactive. If you are concerned about overwriting, then you will always use minus I. At least for my own computer, I always alias. There is a command called alias. I always alias move CP and RM to move minus I, CP minus I, RM minus I. How to alias we will see later, but because I am concerned that I will remove without being sure, I will overwrite without being sure about overwriting. So minus I just ensures that you will be prompted whether to really overwrite only when there is a possibility of overwriting. The other question is, which Linux version do you recommend? So I have been, yeah, this is some question which we can answer in different amounts of detail. Yeah. So I have been using Linux over the last 15 years, and Linux has gone through lots of improvement, lots of changes. Yeah. But always, for many years, Linux used to be very difficult for installation. If you are installing Linux on your own computer, then you have to have lot of systems administration skills. All those skills are not required with Ubuntu version. With the Ubuntu version of Linux, no amount of systems administration is required. So for those of you who want to get started with Linux, just start with Ubuntu. This is what I would strongly recommend. Yeah, as they say, Ubuntu is for humans. Huh? So there, Ubuntu releases two versions every year, one in April, one in October. So 10.04 would mean the version that Ubuntu released in 2010 in April, and 10.10 would mean Ubuntu version released in October 2010. So Ubuntu latest version, meaning 2011 April, is not so stable. So I personally use 10.04, but my colleague here Prashant Dave says that 10.10 is also stable. It is also having hardly any bugs. So you please install either 10.04 or 10.10 and get started with Ubuntu. All kinds of systems administration headaches are not there with Ubuntu. But then we have people in our group who use more advanced, more different Linux versions, which are not as easy for first time users. Okay, there is a, can you repeat less? Somebody has asked a question, can you repeat less? Advanced and powerful Linux for academics is somebody called SJCK16 who has typed. Can you elaborate on that question? What is that Linux, or whether Linux is useful for academics or not? Yeah, we believe it's extremely useful for academics. Yeah, to use Microsoft Windows means to remain inefficient as a user for years and years. To use Linux means spending a little more time for the first 1 month. After that, to become very efficient with file handling, with all the tools that we are going to teach in the next 2 days and also 2 weeks from today. So I am convinced that Linux is going to make us all very, very efficient, not just in academics, for our personal use also. There is one more question on chat. Can you repeat less? The command less that I spoke about, we will see in more detail in some time. Thank you very much. We appreciate your questions. We will certainly like to answer them. Due to time constraints, we are going back to the slides. Thank you. So Linux file hierarchy. So slash itself is a root directory. Yeah, that is the earliest directory. The slash itself does not have a parent directory, I am trying to say. It is the topmost level of the hierarchy. You can also do something called man here, man air. Now, if you have many files, if you have many users working on a computer, then it is very important to know who should be allowed to modify which, who should be allowed to read which files. Yeah, some people might be allowed to read another file, but not write it. For example, all the commands like cp, mv, these are commands that the router has root. The root means systems administrator. Yeah, on every computer in Linux, it is called, the sysad is called the root. The root has given access for using all these commands, but not for removing those commands itself. Each of these commands are themselves files kept somewhere, not inside the home directory, but kept somewhere, and they are all available for using. Also, all these files themselves have to have execute permission. So this is some information that we will study now. So this is called permissions and access control. In a multi-user environment, access control is vital. So as I said, we did ls minus l, it says this information, in which only the first letter d we said meant directory. Yeah, then there are next three letters, again three expected letters, three letters. This is some information which we will not use in this course. This means that particular file belongs to which group. Yeah, so every particular file belongs to a group of users, belongs to a specific user inside that group. Yeah. So this is a group, this is a specific user in the group. This is some file, this is a file size. File size in bits or bytes or kilobytes, megabytes, this is something that you can figure out separately. And this is a date when it was last modified. Please note, this is not the date when it was created, it is a date when that directory was modified. Directory, I should say, also gets modified if a file inside it gets created. Now, what are these RWX? As I said, there is a root who is like super. There is a user. There is that user belongs to a group, and there are all the other people who may not belong to that group but belong to that particular computer. So the first R means read access to the user, then write access to the user. X means execute access. If it is a command itself, if it is a file that requires to be executed, then it should have execute permission. Please have a note about this. When we go back to the shell, we will test this. So in this particular example, root is a group, users is itself the directory about which we are studying. R stands for read access to the user, W stands for the write access to the user, X stands for execute access to the user. The next R dash X means for the group, and the last R something X stands for the rest of the people. So what this says is, there is no write access to others in the group, there is no write access to all others, perhaps not belonging to the group. But they others do have read and execute access. That is extremely important for us to know. Perhaps if this is a very important confidential directory, this is of concern to us, that others can read this, can read the directory. Yeah, they may or may not be able to read the files inside it, but they can go to the directory and see which all files are there. If a file has read access to all others, then that is a potential concern. This is the meaning of read, write, execute permissions of a file of a directory. The first letter itself, as I said, it is a directory, whether it is a directory or a file. Dash means, if there is a dash, it means that that particular expected character, that particular permission is not there. Either the corresponding character is there, if R is there, if the read permission is there, the R letter will appear there, otherwise a dash letter will appear. So the permissions can easily be changed by the owner of the file. So since this particular topic is not required for other topics that we will do today, I would recommend that you read this very carefully later today and ask doubts about this tomorrow. So chmod is the important command to use for changing permissions. We will certainly ask about this in the tests, but because this topic is not required for other topics we will cover today, only for that purpose we are skipping this. Please do not skip studying this, I would like to point out. All the explanation is very self explanatory, that is why. So there is this, as I said, user, U for user, G for group, O for all others. In one go, A stands for all of them. So if you are interested in giving or denying permission to a specific set of users, then plus and minus is what you can use. So as I said, please see the slides carefully later. Also, each particular file has its own owner. Owner itself is the person who can change the permissions. Also, the root perhaps can, on some computers the root also can change the read and write access, execute access of the files. So if you want to change the owner, its ownership itself of the file, chown can do it. So that you can try to do this on your own computer. So the super user is also another word for root. Root is the same as super user, who is the systems administrator who has all the access to that computer. Only very responsible people should have all the access, and we will like that in this course each one of you becomes such a super user. Now coming to how to view a text file. So if there is a file and if it is not a very big file, then you can use cat foo.txt. That particular file called foo.txt can be viewed using cat command. Cat for concatenating all the different lines in that file and showing it on the screen. You can also concatenate different files, show them together on the screen. Important to note, the output comes on the screen and you come again to the prompt waiting. The prompt means, once you have the prompt, means you are now in a position to type a new command again. So cat file name, you can also say cat file 1, file 2, file 3. These are expected to be ASCII files. These are, now it says not convenient to view long files. Why? Because the entire thing will come on the screen in one go, and it will come and you will again end up with the prompt. So if it is a really big file, then you would rather want to see screen, one screen at a time. After you have seen it, then you would like to go to the next screen. For such a long file, cat is not the right command to use, even though it will still output the file, output the content to the screen. That is when you will use less. If the file is really long, you can use a command called less. Less will open the file and show you just one screen full at a time. After you see one, you can press space bar and go to the next. You can also use up, down arrow marks to navigate through it. Finally, after you have navigated enough, when you want to quit from it, Q is the command you have to remember to quit before you open the less, otherwise we will not know how to exit from that less. For more details about how to use less, less minus h or man less is the command to use for seeing how to use this. Less is also very useful for, if you want to now, once you opened a big file and now you are looking for only very specific information, then you can use slash and type the pattern, then it will go to that particular pattern. Slash default, slash will search at this line and below. If you want to look for above this particular line, then question mark is what you can use for searching for a pattern above that particular line. So, less is a command to use for viewing a large file, one can also search for a pattern inside that. Yeah, if there are many, if you want to look for specific files, specific words, then you can use a command called WC word count that can give you the frequency of various frequency of occurrences of various words. Now, if there is a very big file and there is a very there is a specific information you are looking for only at the end of the file, yeah, this is very relevant when you recently wrote an email and now you want to just find that email last, because it was a recent part, you expect that the sent mail will have only at the end, the sent mail will have that relevant information only at the end, that is when you can use tail. For example, if you think that some important information is only at the top, then you can use head. So, these are very useful when you are opening a big file, then less takes a long amount of time to just open the file. I should say still the amount of time I am speaking about is large or small, it is all much less than any Microsoft Windows method of opening a file. Yeah, there we are speaking of some very quick efficient ways of file handling, that is when head and tail are useful. It is useful for only seeing the first few lines or the last few lines of a file. You can use minus n option for specifying the number of lines, default I think it is 20. So, you can also, if you think that some file remains to be requires to be kept open and you want to keep viewing the end of the file, minus f option is there. These additional things can be seen using man tail. Now, extremely important topic is called cut. Yeah, when we are viewing all these text files, then we will often require cutting some important information from a file, then pasting it to another one. This is a topic we will start seeing in more detail after the tea break. I would, for those who have not seen the slides, I would recommend that you see the cut paste related slides very carefully now itself, so that we can go a little faster in the afternoon. We are stopping now. Thank you.